Welcome, my name is Benjamin Berger, and for some time I've wanted to do a video on a new radical idea that was put forth on dinosaur relationships and classification that was published last year in 2017 in Nature, which has either really radical implications for dinosaur classification or is just a bunch of hand waving and will fade slowly from history. Now, I've wanted to talk about it because, to let you know the truth, I've kind of ignored this new idea, but enough people have mentioned it to me that I thought I would do an unbiased video on this new rearrangement of the dinosaur tree. So a quick backstory. In 1887, there was a British paleontologist named Harry Seeley who took an interest in dinosaurs and other extinct animals. And dinosaurs, which had first been described from kind of fragmentary fossils in Britain. But by the 1880s, they were now known from many other parts of the world, and enough skeletons had been found, particularly in the American West, that he was able to notice within these dinosaurs that they could be divided into two major groups. He documented a unique defining feature in the arrangement of the pelvis. Some dinosaurs had a forward projecting pubis bone, while others had a backward projecting pubis bone. And in a lecture in a follow-up paper in 1888, he defined two new suborders of dinosauria, the saurischia, the lizard-hipped dinosaurs, and the ornithischia, the bird-hipped dinosaurs. And since 1887, all paleontologists have supported this bifurcation of the order Dinosauria into these two groups. In 2007, a graduate student named Matthew Barron at Cambridge published an article with two well-known British paleontologists offering a different classification. Now, it's not unheard of a graduate student with an inordinate fondness of dinosaurs to take on a massive study of dinosaur relationships. These modern studies involve examining each fossil and characterizing every bump, groove, protuberance on the fossilized bones into a binary code of states, which are then fed into a computer to analyze relationships between different species. Now, this is very much different than what Harry Seeley did, which was to find a single, large, unique character that defined each group. These modern studies look for the minutiae of features that accumulate in enough statistical support to recognize new groupings of animals. Previous studies using this technique have supported the idea of saurischia and ornithischia as the two unique groups of dinosaurs, and no one has questioned this arrangement before. But Matthew Barron's results were different. He found that ornithischia was paired to some, but not all, saurischian dinosaurs. His paper defined a new grouping of dinosaurs that included all of the previous ornithischian dinosaurs, plus some previous members of the saurischian dinosaurs, including Coelophysis, Eoraptor, and Eodromius. Now, this new group they named Ornithoscelidia, and they also found the traditional theropods like Hererosaurus and Styracosaurus, large carnivores, as ancestral to sauropods, which had also never been proposed either. Now, the study was replicated by other researchers who did not find the same results. In fact, in a reply to the original article, a replicate study found the traditional grouping of dinosaurs into ornithischians and saurischians, noting that there were some mistakes that they found in the characters and how they were scored, particularly for the very fragmentary fossil of Pisanosaurus, recently proposed as sort of the oldest ornithischian dinosaur. This assignment is really highly debated because the specimen is really, really fragmentary. Now, personally, I found that this replicated tree kind of a much better fit in the terms of the placement of Eoraptor, for example, within Sauropoda Morpha, which in Barron's tree was positioned within Theropoda. Now, there are some obvious characteristics in the hand of Eoraptor, such as the twisted shaft of the thumb, indicating that it belongs within the Sauropoda Morpha, a feature highlighted in a paper by Paul Serino and others in 2012. So the fact that Matthew Barron's tree did not resolve this relationship made me a little critical of this new arrangement of dinosaurs. Now, I'm not saying that this study is without merit and that we should ignore it, but a healthy bit of skepticism might be warranted. So let's take a look at what characters support a relationship of Ornithischia with some members of the Saurischia that define this new grouping called Ornithoscelidia. The supplemental file lists 21 character changes that support this new arrangement. Now, 10 of these are proportional or slight shape differences in bones that likely had little in the way of an adaptive difference in functional aspects of how the animal actually lived. The remaining 11 characters are a mix, including the presence or absence of a hole near the snout of the skull, to the shape of the cheekbone, to the position of a small hole in the back of the skull, and the extent that the fibula articulates with the ankle, which may or may not be related to larger body size. And also, the fusion of toe bones. So these characters may reflect morphological differences related to larger body size, for example, grouping larger Triassic dinosaurs like Herrerasaurus and Plateosaurus together, and smaller Triassic dinosaurs like Eoraptor and Lucidosaurus together. So they're not really great, easily to define characters. There's one really odd character state difference listed, and that is a medial ventral acetabular flange of the ilium closes the acetabulum, is present partially or fully closes the acetabulum, or is absent. Now, this character should be absent in all dinosaurs, since the defining character of the clade Dinosauria is an open acetabulum. But the wording, particularly stating partially or fully closes the acetabulum, shifts the origin of the open acetabulum later, with some dinosaurs with a partially closed scored in the same scoring pattern as a fully closed acetabulum. It's a very subtle difference, but it has really important implications, particularly when you're looking at very basal, very early dinosaurs. The last character, and maybe the one that comes to define the group, is the presence of dorsal sacral vertebrae. A dorsal sacral vertebrae is defined simplistically as a vertebrae that is connected to the hip bone. This would help stabilize the hip and spinal bones in dinosaurs. However, later Saurischians also have this trait, particularly Sauropoda Morpha, which have a number of these vertebrae contacting the hip. The fact that Eoraptor is recognized as a basal member of the Ornithoscelidia by the Barta et al. Tree, while others recognize it as a basal Sauropoda Morpha, has me suspect that the development of the dorsal sacral vertebrae may have preceded the early split of Theropoda and Sauropoda Morpha, and maybe even at the very base of the dinosaur tree. and that this trait is very difficult, sometimes impossible to see in very fragmentary Triassic dinosaur fossils. All right, so as you can kind of tell, I'm still highly sort of skeptical of this new arrangement of dinosaurs. I think it's safe to say that the idea of Ornithischia and Saurischia is going to remain in the textbooks for a long time. However, I think this study brings up an important point, that it's very likely that Ornithischia evolved from a Saurischian ancestor, and that the ancestor may have been very similar to early theropods, like Eodromius and Coelophysis. It would not surprise me that with additional fossil discoveries that Ornithischian dinosaurs will be paired with various early Saurischian dinosaurs. Sometime in the Triassic, a geographically widespread small agile bipedal dinosaur developed a new and adaptively important Ornithischian hip, which led to a successful new group of dinosaurs. It's interesting to note that Harry Seeley viewed these two groups having separately evolved from a non-dinosaur ancestor. And that might be the case too. In fact, if we could find a non-dinosaur, a ceratosaurid fossil, with both a closed acetabulum and a Ornithischian hip, which would prove Seeley's original notion correct. And this would blow the minds of dinosaur experts around the world. Because if that was the case, if that were to happen, then the term dinosauria would become obsolete. So in conclusion, I think Ornithischia and Saurischia are going to be around for a while. So don't worry about having to memorize a whole new classification of dinosaurs, at least not yet. Check out the links below if you want to read more about this radical new idea of dinosaur classification, as well as other YouTubers who have taken on this topic. I want to thank my Patreon supporters, Arctotus1811, Dan Chapshaw, Justin Bovey, Pablo Luzato Figuez, and all my Trilobite supporters. You know, without your support, this channel would not be as active, and these videos would exist only in my mind or in lectures to my classrooms. So I want to thank you. It keeps me going, knowing that there are folks out there who are interested in these videos. Thank you very much.